This morning we're going to be looking at one of the last days elements that we've been going through in our seven-part series about the last days. And this morning we're going to talk about the rapture of the church, the rapture of the church. Now, I heard a story about an artist who was very interested in how his art was selling at a local gallery. And so he went down, and as he arrived at the art gallery to meet the owner of the art gallery to ask about his art, he discovered that all of his pictures were gone, removed, disappeared from the walls. And so he asked the owner, he says, what's happened here? And the guy said, well, I've got some good news and bad news for you. He said, the good news is a man came in and he asked all about your artwork. And he asked about the value and what it costs and if the artist passes away, if the value appraises and it goes up. And of course, the owner of the art gallery said, yes, that always happens. When artists die, the value of their art goes up. And when he told him that, the owner of the gallery said, this man, he bought everything. He bought all of your artwork. And the artist said, well, that's great news. What could the bad news be? And he said, well, the man that bought it, he was your doctor. Hey, things are going on behind the scenes that we don't realize. The end is near, and the Lord is working. And we read here in Luke chapter 21, beginning in verse 34, Jesus says this, but take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life, and that day come on you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch therefore, and pray, always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. What things is Jesus talking about when he says, watch and pray that you might be found worthy to escape? Well, Jesus has been speaking about the great tribulation. It's a period of time that's coming on the earth. Jesus would say in Matthew that there's a period coming, Matthew chapter 24, that is worse than any period in all of history, when the wrath of God is poured out on the earth. We read about this throughout most of the book of Revelation, and next week we'll be talking about the Great Tribulation. Jesus, as he's speaking about this, though, says, if you are ready, you will be able to escape. And I believe that Jesus is speaking about the rapture of the church. Now, many people say, I don't believe in the rapture because the word rapture doesn't even appear in the Bible. Well, that's true in one sense, but we'll get to that in a minute. Another people will say, well, the Bible never really even talks about the rapture. Well, this morning we're going to go through all of the scriptures, or most of them, that deal with the rapture. We all have our Bibles, friends. And if the Bible doesn't speak about the rapture, then let's abandon the idea altogether. But if it does, let's stop for one second, avoid this crucial doctrine, this element that builds up our faith and gives us hope in the future. Paul would tell the Thessalonians about these things that with this doctrine comfort one another. And so the doctrine of the rapture of the church is something incredibly comforting. It gives us hope. It purifies us. It strengthens us in time of trial. And so the question might be asked, well, what is the rapture? I believe Jesus speaks about the rapture over in John chapter 14, verse 3. You are familiar with the scripture. I will read it for you. Of course, Peter and James and John and the rest of the disciples were concerned about Jesus because he's been speaking about the fact that he would be going away. Peter, of course, says, Lord, wherever you go, I'll go. These guys might deny you, but I'll stick with you till the end. Jesus says, you're going to deny me before the rooster crows three times. Where I am going, you cannot follow. And they were really bummed out about it. And so Jesus begins to encourage their hearts. And that very well-known passage in John chapter 14, Jesus says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, well, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places, many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. That's the rapture. Jesus will come again and receive us to himself, that where I am, you may be there also. Now, somebody's going to say, well, that doesn't say rapture. Where do you come up with the word rapture? Rapture isn't even in the Bible. Well, turn over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning in verse 15, Paul the Apostle says this to the church. This we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. Now the church in Thessalonica was concerned. They were all waiting for the coming of the kingdom. Everybody in that first century thought that Jesus would be returning at any time. Even when Jesus stood on the Mount of Olives and the disciples were around him, remember what they asked him. They said, "Are you going to at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" And Jesus said, "That's not for you to know. You wait in Jerusalem until you're filled with the Spirit, and then you go out and evangelize. You be my witnesses." But they were very concerned. They were hoping that the kingdom would arrive right then, that Jesus would come again and establish his rule and reign on the earth. And so some of the believers in Thessalonica were getting old. Matter of fact, they even thought that John the Apostle would live until Jesus' return. Remember at the end of the book of John, when Jesus was talking to Peter, and Peter says, "Well, what about this man?" Don't we do that sometimes in our Christian life? The Lord calls us to somebody and something, rather, and we say to him, "Lord, well, what about their calling? I kind of want to do that." And Jesus is telling Peter about the way that he would die. He says, "When you're old, somebody's going to lead you in a place you don't want to go. You're going to be crucified upside down," and as we would find in history. And Peter was upset about that, and he said, "Well, what about John?" And Jesus says, "What if John lives until I come back? What does it matter to you? It doesn't matter to you." And of course, the rumor began that John would stay alive until Jesus came back. So anytime he came down with a cold, maybe a sore throat, everybody got excited. Jesus could be coming back. And so there in the book of John, he writes himself, "Jesus didn't say that I would live until he came back." He just said, "What is that to you? It doesn't matter to you." He tried to dispel sort of that rumor. At any rate, the church was expecting the coming of Jesus Christ. And so in Thessalonica, some of the people were passing away. Some people were, as they would say in the New Testament, they were falling asleep. And the other believers, the other people in the church were thinking, "Well, they've missed the kingdom. They're going to be dead when Jesus Christ comes back. What a bummer." And so Paul writes them and he says, "I don't want you to be ignorant about this thing. Those who sleep in Jesus." Verse 16, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and there the dead in Christ will rise first." And then he says, "We who are alive and remain." Notice Paul thinks that he's going to be there during the rapture. We who are alive. He really believes that he's going to be alive as well. "We who are alive and remain shall be caught up together." And that's the crucial term there, caught up. "Caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words." The word "caught up" is in the Greek language harpazo. It means to snatch away violently or suddenly or quickly. It's the word that Jesus used in John chapter 10 when he says, "All who come to me, all who belong to me, I'm the good shepherd and no one will pluck them out of my hands." It's the word harpazo. It means to steal away, to snatch away quickly. And so when the Latin writers came to this passage and they translated "caught up" harpazo, they translated it with the Latin word raptus. Raptus. That's where we get our English word rapture. Webster's defines the word rapture as a seizing away by violence, to be carried away, and to transport with excitement. Rapture is not just an emotional feeling. "Oh, we were just so in love, it was like rapture." Well, that's not what the Bible talks about when it speaks of rapture. Rapture is being caught up. It's being seized away. Remember that movie Jurassic Park? Remember the dinosaur, Velociraptor? Two words, velocity, which means quickly, raptor, which means to snatch away. And I use that illustration because you will never forget what rapture means from this point on. That's what rapture is. And so you're right. Rapture does not appear in the English Bible, but it does appear in the Latin Bible. Matter of fact, it's the word that's used of Philip. Philip was raptured. Remember Philip? I love Philip. He's a man with four daughters that prophesied. I have four daughters. Philip was evangelist. I want to preach the gospel as well. Well, God told Philip to run down into the wilderness, and there was a man, an Ethiopian eunuch, that was riding in a chariot, and the Lord had spoken to Philip to go down and find himself in this situation. And there he began to run next to the chariot. And he preached the gospel to this eunuch. Powerful situation. A unique opportunity for Philip to preach to this man. And there as they rode by some water, the eunuch said, "Well, why don't I get baptized?" Philip said, "Well, if you believe in Jesus, let's do it." So they got out of the chariot. They got into the water. Philip baptized this eunuch. And we read in Acts chapter 8, verse 39, "When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away." Philip was raptured. And the Bible says there, "So the eunuch saw him no more, He disappeared. Could you imagine being baptized and then gone? The person baptizing you disappears. That's what happened to the eunuch. And the eunuch was pretty excited about that. You know, confirmation from the Lord. This man was from the Lord. And so the Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away. So the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. But the Bible says Philip showed up north, a number of miles at the city of Azotus. Pretty cool stuff. Philip was raptured, caught away, but not into heaven, to another geographical location, just because God wanted to do that. And so the Bible here says that we will be caught up together with the Lord, and we will thus be with the Lord always. And so comfort one another with these words. But it's not just going to be that we're sucked up to heaven like we are. We're going to be changed. Something's going to happen. The velocity at which we go is too much for these old, tired, broken down bodies to bear. Something's going to happen. Our bodies are going to be renewed in such a... Actually, let's just turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Because Paul the Apostle will speak about it there. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 50. It says there, "Now I say this, brethren, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Nor does corruption inherit corruption." In other words, these bodies aren't going to go to heaven. Not like they are. You need a new body to get into heaven. "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep," Paul says. Notice once again, he uses that personal pronoun, we. He doesn't believe that he's going to die. He is ready for Jesus Christ to come back right then. He says, "We will not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." We shall all be changed. Metamorphosis. "We shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye." How fast is that? That's really fast. That's the Greek phrase they would use to measure the shortest span of time. Light travels at 236,237 miles per second. I don't know exactly how fast. But the eye was the only measurement of that speed in those days. And so in that culture, they would say the twinkling of an eye, which is the shortest measurement of time humanly possible. A moment. The twinkling of an eye. It says there, "In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we shall all be changed. At the last trumpet, the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible." And so Paul to the Thessalonians, hey, those people who have fallen asleep, don't worry about it. When Jesus comes for his church, they will be raised incorruptible. In a moment, less than a heartbeat. And not only will the dead be raised incorruptible, we shall all be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and the mortal must put on immortality. And so these bodies will be changed in a moment. We spend so much time making sure these bodies look good, don't we? We spend time in the mirror looking, making sure that we look all right, that our clothes fit. Well, when Jesus Christ comes back, we will be changed. And what will we be like? Well, we'll be like him. Jesus, in his resurrection, was the prototype. His body, that resurrected body, is what we will be like. And so we will be changed. We will be, at that moment, caught up to heaven. Now, it's important to realize that there is a difference between the rapture and the revelation. Get this clear. Because the rapture and the revelation are not the same event. The rapture of the church and the revelation of Jesus Christ are different events. The catching away of the church and the second coming of Jesus Christ are not synonymous events. There is a difference between Jesus coming for his church and Jesus coming with his church. The Bible tells us about Enoch. Enoch was one who prophesied. Jude, verse 14 tells us that Enoch prophesied that God comes with his saints. When Jesus Christ returns visibly, the revelation of Jesus Christ, and this is very important because there are a lot of people out there today that don't believe in the rapture. And they say, well, the rapture and the revelation of Jesus is synonymous. It happens at the same moment. But that's not true. The revelation of Jesus, the second coming of Jesus, is a measurable, timable event. And the reason that we know that they're separate events, for you Bible students, is very simply this. We know exactly when Jesus Christ is coming again. Before you leave, let me explain to you. The Bible explains to us very clearly that in the last days, the Antichrist, which we've studied in previous messages, will come and he will cut a covenant. There will be a treaty between him and Israel, and most likely the surrounding Muslim nations that are hostile to the nation of Israel, the treaty will last for 7 years. In the middle of that treaty, the Bible says that the Antichrist will come and he will take his seat in the temple of God, acting like he is God. And at that point in time, that is what the Bible calls the abomination. Any idolatry is an abomination to God. But this is particularly egregious. It is the abomination that causes the desolation of the whole world. At that moment, what begins is the great tribulation. The whole 7 years you can refer to as the tribulation, but the second half, the last 3.5 years, is what we call in the scripture the great tribulation. It's 42 months, 3.5 years. Or if you want to break it down even more, 1,260 days. I don't break it down just for fun. The Bible breaks it down. Over 12 times in the scripture, we read about this period of time, 1,260 days, 3.5 years. Revelation chapter 11, Daniel chapter 8, Daniel chapter 9. Again and again, the scripture speaks about this period. At the end of that time, because God will pour out his wrath on the earth in the great tribulation, the Antichrist will be seeking to destroy the nation of Israel. Radical period in history. And at the end of that time, Jesus Christ will come again. Every eye will see him, the Bible says. He will come in the cloud with his saints. But the rapture of the church is not knowable. We don't know. Jesus said it very clearly. You don't know the day or the hour. Didn't he say that in Matthew chapter 25? You know not the day or the hour. The rapture is imminent. That is, it can happen at any time. The revelation of Jesus at the second coming, there's a couple of things that need to happen first. First of all, the great tribulation. Jesus said it's like no other time the earth has ever seen. There has to be a temple because Jesus, John, the Apostle Paul, all mention the temple of Israel standing. And so that has to be there. That's not there now. Jesus isn't going to come again with his church until he comes first for his church. And so it's very important to realize, of course, Jesus would say in Matthew chapter 24, verse 44, be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect. Let me tell you, if you're on the earth here during the period of the tribulation, you can measure the days, 1,260 days, from the time the Antichrist puts his butt down on that temple seat until Jesus Christ comes in the air, coming down and letting his feet land on the Mount of Olives. You'll know specifically because the Bible is very clear. But you don't want to be here. You don't want to be here during that time. You'll see everything happen. You'll see the earthquakes. You'll see the famines. You'll see the pestilence. You'll see the mark of the beast. You'll see the one world government. You'll see the apostate Antichrist church. You'll see all of that stuff happen. And you may survive. Very few people will survive the tribulation. I'm not going to talk too much about it because next week we're going to talk about it. But suffice it to say that the Bible says that human beings will be as rare as gold during the period of the tribulation. You could walk the whole earth your whole life and never find another human being. When was the last time you saw a chunk of gold sitting on the side of the road? You just don't. And that's how rare human beings will be, because most of the population of the world will be wiped out during the period of the great tribulation. Now the rapture comes at a time we don't know when it is. Jesus says, watch, be ready. Paul would say to the Thessalonians, Jesus comes. It's as a thief in the night. You don't know when it is. You have to always be on your guard. Always be ready. And so the rapture is imminent. Nothing needs to be fulfilled. We could go in the rapture at any time. Jesus said, watch and be ready. Now, some people will say this. Well, I believe that the church will go through the great tribulation. They would say that we are raptured post-tribulation. And just to give you the definition of terms, the scripture, I believe, is very clear that we will be raptured pre-tribulation. It's called pre-tribulation rapture view. Now, some people say, no, I think the church goes through the tribulation. I don't think so. Here's why. A couple of reasons. First of all, well, basically, it's completely inconsistent with God's nature and his character to judge the righteous with the wicked. That's all. Just God doesn't do that. God doesn't punish other people for things that they're not guilty for. As a matter of fact, Abraham was one of those. He knew that God was consistent in his judgment. Remember when God was about to judge Sodom and Gomorrah? And Abraham stood there and he talked with God and he says, hey, you're not going to destroy the righteous with the wicked, are you? Will not the judge of the earth do what is right? And then, of course, Abraham engages with this bargaining with God, which is wonderful. And now I understand why my relatives, my Jewish relatives, are so good at bargaining. there are Abraham. He says, well, if there are 50, will you destroy it? And God says, no, I won't destroy it for 50. And he goes, okay, well, how about 45? How about 40? How about 20? And he goes on, and he continues to bank on and sort of debate with the nature of God's kindness and his faithfulness. God won't destroy the righteous with the wicked. He just doesn't do it. It's not in his nature. And so there weren't 10 righteous, and God would have spared Sodom and Gomorrah for 10, but there weren't 10. And yet he still will not destroy it because there is one man, Lot, and his wife and his two daughters that are there. And so God sends angels to take them out of Sodom and Gomorrah. Before the wrath of God falls on Sodom and Gomorrah, the angels come and they tell Lot, you've got to get out of here. And remember what the angels said to Lot. There, the angels were very clear, and the angels trying to get Lot out of that city would tell them, we cannot do anything until you depart. And so God will not judge the righteous with the wicked. As a matter of fact, Romans chapter 5, verse 9 says it very clearly. How much more then, having been justified by his blood, shall we be saved from his wrath? We will be saved from his wrath. Also, 1 Thessalonians 5:9. Romans 5:9, 1 Thessalonians 5:9. Remember that 5:9. Two places. Because Paul says there in 1 Thessalonians 5:9, God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, some people will say, well, you pre-tribulation rapture people, are you're just into escapism. And I say, amen, because that's what Jesus said. Luke 21, watch and pray that you might escape. We are not appointed to wrath. Remember, the wrath of God is poured out in Revelation chapters 6 through 19, right there in the beginning. Remember what they said, Revelation 6, verse 16 and 17. They crawled into the caves of the mountains as the punishment of God begins to get poured out on the earth. And they cried out to the rocks. They said, bury us, cover us, hide us from the face of the Lamb whose wrath has come. The great, terrible day of his wrath has come. That's the tribulation. Now, some people will say, well, Jesus said you will suffer tribulation in this world. That's true. But there is a huge difference between the tribulation that comes from the world and the tribulation that comes from God. The wrath of the devil is something we all face. You deal with it. When you live righteously in this world, you're going to suffer. People aren't going to like you. They're going to look at you cross-eyed. And people hate you in this world. Jesus said, if the world hated me, they're going to hate you too. Don't worry about it. And then he promised, he said, in this world, you will have tribulation. But take courage. I have overcome the world. And so there is a tribulation from the world, but there's the great tribulation, which is the wrath of God. Now, we will be saved from that. Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 7 through 9, he says, God delivered Lot, whose righteous soul was vexed or oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked. Don't you get oppressed? Don't you feel vexed when you look at the crazy things that are going on in the world today? Because your soul is righteous. You desire to see God glorified, but God is denigrated. You desire to see righteousness elevated, but wickedness is elevated. In the world, that's just the way it is. And so the Bible says that Lot was oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked, verse 8 of 2 Peter 2. For that righteous man dwelling among them tormented his righteous soul from day to day by seeing and hearing their lawless deeds. But then Peter goes on and says in verse 9, the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptation and reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment. There are a couple of other examples of God saving the righteous before his wrath is poured out on the earth. Noah was one. God wouldn't pour out the flood on the earth to judge human beings on the planet until Noah was safely and securely sealed in that vessel that was prepared to protect him from the wrath of God. And we read there in Genesis that God himself closed the door. Noah was commanded to seal the inside and the outside with pitch or with tar, with sap, so that the waters of judgment would not come in. It's a beautiful type, by the way, of our salvation, because as we come into Jesus Christ, we are saved from the wrath which is to come. And so Noah and his family, those eight people, were saved from the wrath of God. And I don't know if that's so much a good illustration of the rapture. I think that might be a good illustration of those who are sealed from God's judgment in the book of Revelation. We read about 144,000 who are sealed by God to go through the tribulation, but those are Jewish people. Those are the nation of Israel once again. I think a better picture of God's rapture in the period of Noah is that of Enoch. Do you remember Enoch? Just before the flood, God actually raptured somebody. Enoch, we read about in Genesis chapter 5, verse 24, the Bible tells us Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. That's an archaic way of saying that Enoch was walking with God, and then we didn't see him anymore. He disappeared. God raptured Enoch. God also raptured a man by the name of Elijah, but we'll save that for later. Daniel is another interesting type. Remember in the book of Daniel when Nebuchadnezzar got that head trip and he wanted to be the ruler of the world and he made an image of gold for all the world to bow down to. It was kind of like the Antichrist. And that image of gold was 60 cubits high, 6 cubit wide, and as you read through the book of Daniel, we read that they had 6 different types of instruments. An amazing picture of 666. And he demanded that the whole world bow down and worship this image. But those Israelis, those 3 stubborn, righteous men of God, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, refused to bow. Nebuchadnezzar got angry. He said, heat that furnace 7 times. And they said, you can do whatever you want. God can save us from your hand. And even if he doesn't, we'll be saved anyway. We'll be saved from death or by death. It doesn't matter to us. No matter what, Nebuchadnezzar, we're not bowing down to your image. And he got so enraged, his face changed. He had the furnace heated 7 times. The guys throwing the firewood in there, they burned. And then they were thrown in. Nebuchadnezzar looked. There were more than 3. There was a 4th. And he said, I thought we threw 3 guys in there. How come I see 4? They weren't dead. They were walking around in the fire. And Nebuchadnezzar saw, I see the one of a 4th. It looks like the Son of Man. And there was walking with them Jesus. Funny thing to me about that whole story is that Nebuchadnezzar has to call them to come out. He says, hey guys, you know, buddies. You know, he's friends with them now because they're walking around in this roaring fire. And there they are, and Nebuchadnezzar says, why don't you come out? It's amazing to me. They would rather be with Jesus in the trial than with Nebuchadnezzar in the world. And so they come out, and it says they weren't even singed. They didn't even smell like smoke. You say, well, how's that a picture of the pre-tribulation rapture of the church? Well, the picture is this. Where's Daniel? Where's Daniel? The Holy Spirit has left him out of that story completely. Daniel is the main character in the book of Daniel, but he's disappeared. He is completely absent from this period of time where the world is bowing down to the image, the mark of the beast, the abomination of desolation prefigured in the Old Testament. Daniel's gone. It's a picture, I think, of the rapture of the church. The book of Revelation also helps us to understand a little more. Turn to Revelation chapter 1, verse 19. The book of Revelation has its own divine outline for us. Helps us to understand. The book of Revelation is a very simple book to understand when you realize that it has its own outline. In verse 19 of chapter 1, we read about it. It says here, write the things which you have seen. Point number 1. And the things which are. Point number 2. And the things which will take place after this or after these things. There are 3 sections to the book of Revelation. Chapter 1 is the things which you have seen. What was that? Well, that was the picture that John wrote of the risen and glorified Jesus Christ. His eyes a flame of fire, his feet like burnished bronze, his hair white as snow, his face shining like the sun. It was an encouragement to the church. Jesus is alive. And this is what you're going to be like when you're resurrected. When you see him, you will be like him, for you will see him as he is. That's encouraging to see Jesus and to meditate on those elements. And so those are the things which you have seen, John. And then he says, write the things which are. And that would be chapters 2 and 3. The things about the church. John writes about the things which are. Chapters 2 and 3 deal with the 7 letters to the church. They deal with specific churches. They deal with the churches that existed geographically in that time. But it also deals with every church age. There are all these different kinds of churches. Messages that relate to them where they're at. But the interesting thing is if you look at these 7 churches, you can lay them out and they sort of unfold the history of the church. Beginning in Ephesus. Beginning in that first century church and then going through the movement of church history. And you can lay that out. We'll go through it when we go through the book of Revelation. At any rate, we realize that the last church is what? The church of Laodicea, that perverse church. They were rich and they were wretched. Remember that at the end of chapter 3 of Revelation? And there is Jesus knocking. He's trying to come in. He's not even in the church. And we've read that the church in the last days, the last church prior to the coming of Christ, is an apostate church. Jesus isn't even in it. They're having church. They're wealthy. But the Bible says they're lukewarm. Jesus says, you know what? I wish you guys were hot, or I wish you were cold, but you're lukewarm and I want to throw you up. You make me sick. And that's the church just prior to the end. Why? Chapter 4, verse 1. Look at Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. John says this, after these things, aha, after these things, the Greek phrase there is metatauta. After these things, after what things? After the church age, after church history, after the unfolding of God's revelation to His church and through His church in the world. After these things, John says, I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me. And the voice said, the trumpet said, come up here and I will show you the things which must take place after this, metatauta, after these things. So here's the third section of the book, Revelation 4 to the very end. And immediately John says, I was in the spirit and behold, there was a throne set. And so John is caught up into heaven and I think it's a picture of the rapture. What happens after this? Well, the wrath of God is poured out. Those who are in heaven, John sees this huge crowd of people. And they're singing to the Lord. Who is it? Actually, you can read the song that they're singing in chapter 5. And you know who it is by the lyrics. What are they singing? Chapter 5, verse 9. They sang a new song. And they said, you are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals. For you were slain and had redeemed us to God by your blood. Who can say that? An angel can't say that. An animal can't say that. Only you can say that. You will be caught up to heaven. You might as well read these lyrics because you're going to need to know the words. Because we're going to sing them when they're up there. It says, you have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe, every tongue, every people, and every nation, every ethnos, every people group. And here we are, represented many different people groups. We're all going to stand before God. We're going to be clothed white in the blood of Jesus Christ, washed, cleansed, pure. And we'll be able to say, you've redeemed us from all time, from all people. And we'll stand with Him. And we'll sing that. And then Jesus Christ comes and He begins to break open the seals of this scroll. And every time He breaks open a seal, these wax seals that would hold these books together, the judgment of God is poured out. And then when He breaks the last one, then these bowls are poured out, this judgment on the earth, and the planet's population is decimated. And the people on earth curse God to His face. And the Antichrist rises and they worship him rather than worshiping God. And all of a sudden, all of these things begin to unfold amazingly. All the elements that we've been looking at will rapidly fall into place. The Antichrist, the false prophet, the false religion, the one world government, the rebuilding of the temple, the people of Israel being persecuted. A peace treaty will be cut in the Middle East with Israel and her Muslim neighbors, and a new Europe and this new charismatic leader that rises on the scene. It'll all happen so quickly, like dominoes. The church will be gone. As a matter of fact, there will be amazing peace on the earth for about 3.5 years until that man, probably going in to inspect the building of the new temple. It's probably based, that covenant, that treaty that he makes with them. He says, I'll make peace with your Muslim neighbors, and I'll let you build a temple just next to the Dome of the Rock, that golden dome next to the Al-Aqsa Mosque on the Temple Mount. I'll let you build it. We'll actually put United Nations troops here. The Bible says that the nations will dominate the Temple Mount for 42 months, 3.5 years. Until the end comes. The Bible says it's clear. And then, when that man sits down on the temple, Jesus says, when you see the abomination spoken of by Daniel the prophet sitting in the temple. How could everybody see that except there were webcams in there? I don't know. It's just something on a side note, by the way. It could only happen in our day. Nobody can see into the holy place except today. There are thousands of cameras all over the place for security. You can check all over England, the United States. Well, I believe in the building of the new temple, there'll probably be a camera there. And it'll film right in that area where the Antichrist will come in. You'll almost see his horns sprouting out of his forehead. I don't know if you'll see that. And he'll sit down and he'll say, why don't you just worship me as God? And you'll be able to click on it. You'll see it. Jesus says, when you see that, run into the wilderness. And the Jews will see that. Matter of fact, the Bible gives this whole picture of it in Revelation chapter 12. Very important chapter of the Bible to know. It says there was a woman and she was clothed with the sun and the moon and she had 12 stars on her head. Well, who is that woman? Well, it's obviously the nation of Israel because that was the dream that Joseph had. He said, you know, the sun and the moon, they bowed down to me and all the stars bowed down to me. And Joseph said, hey, are your mom and I and your brothers going to bow down to you? It's the people of Israel. And it says she was about to give birth to a child. And she had the doula from hell there, the devil, Satan himself as a dragon, ready to eat the body of this Christ. He wanted to eat the body of Christ when he came out. And the Bible says there in Revelation 12, we're not going to go through it verse by verse. We don't necessarily have the time. And yet the Bible says Satan wanted to devour Jesus, but it tells us there in chapter 12, verse 5, she bore a male child who was to rule the nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up, harpazo, raptured to heaven. I believe it speaks of Jesus, but it also speaks of the body of Jesus. It speaks of Jesus Christ and the body of Christ. And as soon as he was caught up to heaven, it says there, he was caught up to God and his throne, reference chapter 4, verse 2, I was immediately in the spirit, and there was a throne. And so the church is caught up. And what does Satan do? What does the dragon do? He begins to turn back his hostility on the woman, on Israel. And the Bible says he chases her into the wilderness. And there it says in Revelation chapter 12 that the wings of an eagle were given to Israel. There they're running. And I believe there's another prophecy that's probably good for another time, but Isaiah chapter 40 tells us those who wait on the Lord will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not grow weary. And I personally believe that as Israel and as those people who finally look at the scripture and say, we've been wrong this whole time, this man's not the Christ, this man is the Antichrist. He'll sit there and they'll read the scripture where Jesus says, when you see this happen, run to the wilderness. And they'll begin to run and a miracle will happen. The Bible here in Revelation 12 says the wings of an eagle were given to the woman and she fled into the wilderness. Elijah ran and it says that he didn't grow tired. Remember there in the Old Testament when he ran and he outran the chariots of God. Luke chapter 4 tells us that Elijah was in the wilderness 3.5 years as a type of Israel being in the wilderness. They will run and not grow weary. I would love that. I would love to run and not grow weary. I cannot run and not grow weary. And it says they will walk and not faint. And I can almost hardly do that anymore nowadays too. They're just running. No lactic acid. No burnout. And they just make it into the wilderness. God will prepare them a place to be saved. The Bible says the woman was given two wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time, times, and half a time, 3.5 years from the presence of the serpent. And then Jesus Christ will come back and we will come back with him. The Antichrist can't be revealed until the church is taken out of the way. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8 says, the mystery of lawlessness, the man of sin, the Antichrist, is already at work in the world. Only he who now restrains the Holy Spirit will do so until he is taken out of the way. Then the lawless one will be revealed. The Holy Spirit working in the church, in the world, through you, is actually holding back the revelation of the Antichrist. But when the church, the body of Christ, is taken out of the way, then all hell will break loose. And at the same time, all heaven will break loose. John says, I saw a war going on in heaven, and Satan was cast down. And then the people of Israel will turn, they'll cry out, they'll call on Jesus, and he'll return. And as we close, I believe that the Lord has left it for us to constantly be expecting this. Now, there are some people that say, no, the resurrection has taken place already. The second coming has occurred already. We'll save it for another study. It's called preterism. Beware of preterism. Preterism is dominant in the church today, as a matter of fact. They say Jesus Christ came back already, that the resurrection already took place in 70 AD. Paul would warn Timothy, he says, Hymenaeus and Philetus, they say the resurrection's already taken place, and they upset the faith of so many people. There's a doctrine out there that says there's no place for Israel in the plan of God. There is no millennial kingdom, 1,000-year reign. There is no rapture. There is no resurrection. The resurrection already took place in 70 AD. Hogwash. Preterism, I think, leads to anti-Semitism in one way. And you're not looking now for the coming of Jesus Christ, for his church. But John tells us in 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 and 3, beloved, we are children of God, and it hasn't been revealed what we will be, but we know that when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. We want to be ready. Luke gives that parable. Luke chapter 12, verses 43 through 48. Looking to the rapture does an amazing thing in your life. It prepares you. We read there in Luke chapter 21 when we started. Jesus said, I don't want you to be weighed down with carousing and drunkenness. I don't want you to be distracted by the world. I want you to be looking, watching, be ready so that you can escape. John tells us that if we have this hope fixed on him, we purify ourselves. Jesus will say in Luke chapter 12, verses 43 through 48, he says this. He says, blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he'll make him a ruler over all that he has. But if that servant says, notice this, chapter 12, verse 45, if that servant says, my master is delaying his coming, and he begins to beat the male and female servants, and he begins to eat and drink and be drunk, the master of that servant will come on a day when he's not looking for him, and in an hour when he's not aware, he'll cut him in two and appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. If you're not watching, if you're not waiting, if you say, the Lord's not coming back, careful, be careful. Because that's what Peter said. In the last days, they will come and say, all things continue as they have from the beginning. Since the fathers, it's all. Where is the promise of his coming after all? They're fulfilling prophecy. Jesus says, you watch out. Because if you're not looking for and you're not hoping toward the coming of the Lord, you're going to begin to get trapped in the things of this world. You're going to beat up on other people. You're not going to live a life of love and passion and desperation. But as it says here, you're going to begin to beat the other servants. You're going to begin to be critical and hostile toward those who don't know Jesus Christ. You'll begin to live not based on the law of love, but the law of hatred. And then in addition to that, you're going to get stuck in the things of this world. You're going to be living for pleasure, drunkenness. Jesus said that in Luke 21 as well. As a matter of fact, Paul will say it in 1 Thessalonians verse chapter 5. I will read it for you. Chapter 5, verse 6 through 11, Paul the Apostle says this. For those who sleep, sleep at night. Those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let those who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love. As a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God didn't appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us. That whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort one another. Earlier in that passage, Paul says, the coming of the Lord is like a thief in the night. And that's the context. There's great comfort in this. Not only does it help me purify myself, not only does it help me to separate from the things of the world, but I take great comfort, you know, because you suffer. There are things in this life where you just want them to end. You want them to be over. There are people that are broken, that are hurting, that are sick. Know this, that the Lord is coming and he'll take you out of here. This morning I got up relatively early and my mom has a treadmill upstairs. And it's been my practice for a whole 3 days now to run on the treadmill. I'm pretty happy about it, actually. But I notice something happens in my body, in my mind, even in my heart. I will be dying, you know, going nowhere, just running on a treadmill like a rat, you know, like a hamster, just going, what am I doing here? And then I'll hear the footsteps of my wife coming up the stairs. Man, I straighten up. I am looking good now. I'm running. Why? Because I know she's coming. And I want to do as well as I can because she's coming. And I want her to find me doing the will of the Lord, so to speak. You see my illustration. When I'm looking toward the heavens, when I'm looking toward the skies, I'm going to do my best to run. Not because it dictates whether or not I go to heaven, but because I want to be pleasing to the one who loves me. And so I run. I straighten up. I strengthen the feeble knees, for as it says in the book of Romans, our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. So strengthen your hands and your knees. Look up, for your redemption draws near. One final story. It's in 2 Kings chapter 2. You can look at it later. We read about Elijah, this amazing man of God used in the nation of Israel. He was raptured, by the way. He was taken to heaven in a whirlwind. But Elijah's protege, Elisha, was following with him. And as Elijah and Elisha went along from city to city, we read that the people there that were students of the prophets, the schools of the prophets, these men that looked to Elijah as their mentor, their leader, they kept saying to Elisha, "You know, your master is going to be taken from you today." And Elisha would respond, "Yes, hold your peace." Loose translation, "Yeah, shut up. I know that." And they kept trying to discourage him from going on with Elijah because Elijah was going out to the wilderness. And from city to city, town to town, from little school to little school, all of these sons of the prophets would come out and say, "Elisha, you know, why are you going with him? He's going to be taken to heaven today." Somehow it was revealed to them. They knew that he was going to be taken to heaven. They knew there was a rapture coming. But they just hung out in their little schools and they didn't go. But Elisha said, "No, I'm going to go." And finally, Elijah turns to him and says, "What do you want from me?" He kept trying to ditch him, you know. "What do you want from me? What do you want from me?" And finally, Elisha says, "What God has done in you, the anointing you have, I want twice that." Elijah says, "Well, you've asked a tough thing. But I'll tell you what, if you see me when I go into heaven, it'll be done for you." You remember the story? And then they walked, and I imagine Elisha just stared at him the whole time. "Why don't I watch?" They got to the Jordan River. Elisha took off that mantle, that sort of covering, that robe. That mantle was amazing. You know, it was the thing that actually it called Elisha from the beginning. Elisha, when he was in the field, Elijah came and he threw this mantle, covered his head. "Well, that's weird." And Elisha said, "Okay, I'll follow you." And so this was the mantle. It was an amazing thing. And the mantle was the thing also that Elijah wrapped around his head. Remember when he was in the cave down in the Sinai Peninsula there at Mount Horeb? And he knew that God was outside the cave and there was a fire. There was an earthquake. There was all these things going on, and God wasn't in any one of them. He wasn't in the earthquake. He wasn't in the huge wind. He wasn't in the fire. But then there was a still small voice. Remember that? And he wrapped the mantle around his head, and he went out there and he stood and he spoke with God. The mantle was an amazing thing. And there Elijah takes it off as they're at the Jordan River, and he smacks the river, and it opens up, dry ground. And there Elisha and Elijah walk through. And as they walk through, they're talking and they're walking, and Elisha is looking at Elijah and he is attached to him. And then it says that a whirlwind, a chariot from God, came and it lifted up Elijah right there in their presence. It says that Elijah was looking. As they continued on and talked, suddenly a chariot of fire appeared with horses of fire, and it separated the two of them, and Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it, and he cried out, and he said, "My father, my father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." And so he saw him no more. And he took hold of his own clothes, and he tore them. And there, coming out of heaven, was sort of this mantle. Here it comes, drifting down. And Elijah, his mantle falls, and Elisha picks it up. And he went back, and he stood by the bank of the river. And he took that mantle, and he slapped the river, and he said, "Where is the God of Elijah? Was my prayer answered? The anointing that I hoped for, is it mine?" And the river opened up, and he went through. And all those prophets, those people that stayed back, they said, "Where's Elijah?" He said, "He went to heaven. You got raptured. He was taken. I saw it. My eyes were on it. I watched him. Because my anointing, the basis of my anointing, were keeping my eyes on the skies." They said, "Well, we better go find his body." Elisha says, "You're not going to find his body." They said, "We better find it." And they badgered him till he was ashamed, the Bible says. And they went out and they looked for this body. They wanted to hold on to something. But the God of Elijah was there. The anointing was there. And the lesson is this. Your life as a Christian is like that. If you keep your eyes on the skies, you'll have the Holy Spirit as a prize. That is, if you focus your life on the coming again of Jesus Christ, that hope of heaven, looking for the rapture, that blessed hope that the Bible calls it, your life will be one that is anointed. The presence of the Lord will be with you. You will walk in the fullness of His power. So be careful not to do like that wicked servant did and said, "Oh, where's the promise of His coming? My master delays," and get sucked into the things of the world. Rather than that, let's join together. Comfort one another with this knowledge that Jesus Christ is coming back. And it could be today. It could be tomorrow. We don't know exactly. But we have this hope fixed on Him. And with that hope comes power, comes healing, comes comfort, comes the knowledge that all of this in this world is going to pass away. But my Lord's coming again. Amen.